All right, what's happening, y'all? It's your boy Rico from Street Scores, and man, I have some pretty bad news. They done put my boy Logan Thomas on the IR. Again, with the new IR rules this season, kind of started last season somewhat, but there were some minor changes made this offseason as well to add to it. When you're placed on IR, you have to stay a minimum of 4 weeks now. It's not half the season, the entire season, none of that. And you can also bring as many players back from IR as you want to, unlimited players. So the NFL, with the whole COVID-19 situation, has just loosened up on a lot of the rules. I mean, they added a 17th game, but they didn't increase 53-man rosters to a larger roster like 55 or maybe even 57, 58 or whatever. So they loosened up on the IR rules instead. Not to say that they'll never increase the roster cap, but as of right now, we're lucky that Logan Thomas will only have to miss 4 weeks at the very least, rather than it being half the season or more. And then the Washington football team also went out there to sign Jay Sternberger. I'm gonna break him down as well. And then we have to talk about all of the injuries on the team. Our injury report today was extensive and it's scary. I'm definitely worried about it. But before we dive into all of that, make sure you subscribe to the channel, hit the bell next to the subscription button so you get a notification immediately. And every time I release an informative and opinionated video just like this one, check out all of my recent videos. Again, all 22 footage is supposed to be coming NFL Game Pass, and they said you have to wait 36 to 48 hours after the game, but it's still not working, even though there is a screen for it. But when you try to click on it, it doesn't work yet. But as soon as that's working, y'all are getting film sessions all season, so stay tuned for all of that. Without further ado, let's get it. All right, so Logan Thomas with the hamstring injury he suffered against the Falcons on Sunday. First drive of the game, too. That sucked. He has now been placed in IR. Originally, they said he'll be like week to week, but maybe it's like a Curtis Samuel situation where it's not that bad, but they just want him to rest and focus on getting healthy rather than hurting himself and making his injury worse, trying to hurry back as soon as possible. Because guys like Curtis Samuel and especially even Logan Thomas realize that they are needed for this offense to work as well as we want it to, especially with Logan Thomas being our best tight end. Curtis Samuel is a great receiver, but he's not our best receiver. We already have Terry McLaurin. With Logan Thomas, that's going to be an even bigger hole left in the offense. And that's just making things harder on Taylor Heinicke and Scott Turner. But like I said in the intro, he has to miss a minimum of 4 weeks. So if you think about it, he will at least have to miss the Saints, Chiefs, Packers, and Broncos games. And then he's eligible to come back by the bye week. So technically, he'll have 5 weeks off. And hopefully by then he'll be fully recovered, because if he's not, they'll just keep him on IR even longer. But I'm assuming by then he should be good, because originally it was supposed to be week to week. So apparently the injury wasn't that bad, but they wanted to place him on IR. I guess we'll see when Ron Rivera speaks about it in a press conference exactly why they went that route rather than just keeping him week to week. And I'm assuming one of the reasons that they went ahead and just put him on IR, if they expect him to at least be hurt for the next 2 weeks, is because they wanted to bring in tight end Jace Sternberger off of the Seahawks practice squad. And Ron Rivera already said in a press conference yesterday, or I believe it was Monday, that Samus Reyes is going to get a great opportunity against the Saints to show what he can do. This is going to be his first game being active in his NFL career. He's been on a 53-man roster, but he's been inactive every game so far this season. And Ron Rivera said that he'll get a chance to show what he can do against the Saints. But when you bring in Jace Sternberger, does that mean that Samus Reyes will be inactive going into that Saints game again? Like, does Jace Sternberger immediately replace Logan Thomas? And not even just as far as active goes, but as far as depth chart, are they bringing in Jace Sternberger to be our number one tight end, keep John Bates as your blocking tight end? You saw him on special teams pancake that guy. He pancaked somebody else on offense, and he also missed the block as well. I believe it was on that Taylor Heinicke throw to Terry McLaurin where he just threw it up there, and then Terry somehow caught it for that second touchdown towards the end of the game. And then you have Ricky Seals-Jones as your receiving option. He had a great catch against the Giants, but couldn't catch anything thrown towards him against the Falcons. Even though the one on that two-point conversion wasn't his fault, Taylor Heinicke just threw it so high that it had to be two Ricky Seals-Joneses stacked on top of each other to catch that one. By the way, this is really interesting. If you remember, Jace Sternberger coming out of Texas A&M was Pro Football Focus highest graded SEC tight end in the 2019 class. And he was drafted with the 75th pick overall in that 2019 draft by the Green Bay Packers. And he was also ranked the top pure receiving tight end out of the entire 2019 class, including all tight ends, not just the SEC. And then when it came to the draft, Pro Football Focus ranked their top 10 tight ends. He was third, only behind TJ Hockenson and Noah Fant, which is nothing to be ashamed of. He was ahead of Dawson Knox, ahead of Caleb Wilson, Irv Smith Jr. And we saw what Dawson Knox did against us when we played the Bills. And he's actually been a really good fantasy option every week other than, I believe, just week one. And in 2018, his final season in college before the draft, he ran the second most routes out of any tight end in the country. Josh Oliver ran 439, Jay Sternberger ran 415, and nobody else even reached 380. So he has a lot of potential as a receiving tight end. You could almost consider him a slot receiver, kind of like Mike Gesicki. So then you have to wonder, why was somebody this talented coming out of college and with such high hopes and expectations just available like this? Not only was he on a team's practice squad, but it wasn't even a team's practice squad that drafted him. The Packers was like, y'all can have him. And then the Seahawks took him and they didn't even have him on his active roster. And now we're bringing him in to replace Logan Thomas potentially. And when I went back and looked at it and did some research, because I haven't really kept up with Jay Sternberger, I'm gonna be completely honest with y'all, I don't watch Jay Sternberger all 22 film just on a regular day basis. But when I went back and looked just a few minutes to an hour ago, it's just drops. He has the potential to be a really good receiving tight end. And if you consider all the tight ends on our roster and where they were drafted and expectations they had coming into the NFL, Jay Sternberger does have the highest expectations, the highest ceiling or whatever, other than Samus Reyes. So it's like, if you could just fix those drops, work on his route running a little bit more, and get him to become a better blocker, which Pete Haener has shown he could do. He's made every tight end we brought here into a better blocker. Now, are all of them good to great? No. But Pete Haener has clearly shown that he can take a tight end and get them to block better than they originally could before he got their hands on them. So I believe in Pete Haener. I mean, he took Logan Thomas, who everybody was questioning why we even picked him up, because the Lions clearly didn't care about him, and turned him into a top seven tight end in the NFL. And then you've already seen how much progress Samus Reyes has made just within these past few months, going from not even knowing what a zone defense is to being a pretty decent tight end with loads of potential. But at least Pete Haener has gotten him to at least show you some technique refinement, some ability to catch the ball, on top of all of that limitless athleticism and potential. Samus Reyes is still raw, but he's not just this raw ball of clay that can't do anything. You could argue he's probably our best blocking tight end on roster right now from what we've seen in the preseason, but it's mostly because of how physical he is. But it doesn't matter how physical you are if you have no technique. So even though he doesn't have a lot, Pete Haener helped him get some, and just some technique, some route running, some hands with Samus Reyes' athleticism still equals a really good tight end. But I definitely hope he improves, because I want to see him on the field. I want to see him on the field as soon as possible against this Saints game. If he can, I would love to, just to see where he's at so far. But again, back to Jay Sternberger, he has a boatload of potential. Now, he's not the most athletic guy. He has average athleticism. He has a 5.9 score on the RAS, which tracks every player's athleticism. It's a relative score. So, of course, a tight end isn't supposed to run as fast of a 40 time as a cornerback. And all of that is taken into account with the algorithm and all of the calculations the RAS uses to measure how athletic a player is. And Jay Sternberger, again, has a 6 out of 10, which is not bad. That's more athletic than a few players we even drafted in this draft class. But he's not the freak athlete of a Samus Reyes. But who is, honestly? So we'll see. We'll see how much Jay Sternberger plays. Again, he's already been signed to the 53-man roster, not even just the practice squad. So I'm expecting us to potentially maybe even roll out there with four tight ends against the Saints. Because again, I want to see Samus Reyes play, and even Ron Rivera already said that we would. But who knows? That was before we signed Jay Sternberger. Maybe he goes back on his word as far as that goes after we find a guy to replace Logan Thomas as potentially our tight end one. But then it's all these other injuries on the team that I'm really worried about. Because today, on top of Logan Thomas not participating in practice and then eventually going to the IR later in the day, you also have De'Ami Brown with his knee injury, Antonio Gibson with his shin injury, Cole Holcomb with his shoulder, Curtis Samuel with his groin, Brandon Sheriff with his knee, and of course he's missing 3 to 4 weeks, and Cam Sims with his hamstring. All of those guys did not participate in practice today. But wait, there's still more to talk about. limited in practice. You have Jonathan Allen with his knee, our best defensive player so far this year. DeShazer Everett with his knee, and I'm not even exactly sure when he played. Did he play on that last snap and also get hurt like Torrey McTyer on the last play of the game? Then you have Matt Ioannidis, of course, with his knee. JD McKissick, the hero, with the ankle injury. Jane Smith-Williams in a limited role with his toe. And man, if anything that last game should have taught you is that we need Benjamin St. Juice healthy, and he was a limited participant today with his concussion injury. Hopefully he's able to get out of concussion protocol by the time we play the Saints, because boy, I like Torrey McTyer, and Kendall Fuller, I still believe in you a little bit, but Benjamin St. Juice has easily been our most consistent and dependable corner this year. William Jackson has probably made the most plays, but he's also had more lows than Benjamin St. Juice has had. Benjamin St. Juice has been just the most even killed, dependable corner so far. Again, the Chargers game was weird because if you really look at it, he had great coverage on a lot of those plays. It was just a better throw and a better catch. And great offense is always going to beat great defense in the NFL. That's just how the rules are set up. So I wasn't even mad at Benjamin St. Juice there. But I'm mad at Kendall Fuller, William Jackson, and Torrey McTyer for the times that they got beat against the Falcons, against the Bills, against the Giants. Those are inexcusable. Those are just, they're not anywhere near them. They're not close enough or whatever. Benjamin St. Juice has been close to guys. They just been getting them. Unless it's been zone coverage, and then everybody's been making mistakes in zone coverage. We just have terrible communication. But when it's man on man, Benjamin St. Juice has been our most consistent corner. I really hope he's healthy. But again, just everybody else. I mean, we're finally starting to get the offense flowing. Taylor Heineke's getting into a rhythm. Scott Turner's becoming a more consistent play caller, even though I won't call him great yet. But he has flashes every game. And then now you have De'Ami Brown, Antonio Gibson, Curtis Samuel, even Cam Sims, JD McKissick, all hurt. And then on the defensive side of the ball, we're already struggling. Now, Cole Holcomb, who was one of our better players against the Falcons. Jonathan Allen, who's literally been our best defensive player on the entire team so far this year. Matt Ioannidis, who's very helpful. And then backups DeShazer Everett and Jane Smith-Williams are also hurt. And then again, y'all already know about Brandon Scherff and Logan Thomas missing at least the next 3 to 4 weeks. So man, I hope we can figure it out. Hopefully we get better news Thursday and Friday when those injury reports come out. But as of right now, as in today, Wednesday, it's looking pretty ugly. But this Jay Sternberger signing should leave us a little optimistic. At least they're making moves. Just sadly, it's not the moves that we were hoping for. When Stephon Gilmore was available, CJ Henderson was available, Jalen Smith is still available. We go and get Jay Sternberger, but at least they're doing something and not nothing at all. But yeah, man, that's the end of this video. Please get in the comment section and let me know how you feel about this whole situation. Is it time to panic? I mean, it's getting a little ugly, but hopefully everybody can recover, because at least we don't have any out for season injuries at the end of the day. A lot of teams' players are gone for like 8 or more weeks. We don't have anybody that's just super gone 8 or more weeks, except for Ryan Fitzpatrick. But that's been a blessing in disguise, because Taylor Heineke's been balling, and who knows what Ryan Fitzpatrick would have been doing out there. I don't want to wish injuries on Ryan Fitzpatrick, of course, but I'm just saying that with Taylor Heineke getting a chance to ball out and with what he's done, you can only assume that it would have been worse with Ryan Fitzpatrick, because Taylor Heineke's been playing like a top at least 15 quarterback so far this season. But yeah, again, we have a lot of injuries, but none of them are terrible. So hopefully we can get a lot of these guys ready to play against the Saints, because if we don't, it's going to be ugly. Because the Saints are definitely a better team than the Falcons. They're not a top team. They're not the Chiefs, the Broncos, the Packers, who all we have to play before Logan Thomas even returns, before the bye week. But they're still better than the Falcons, who we just went toe-to-toe with. But yeah, man, please like this video if you liked it. If you learned anything, please subscribe if you haven't. Of course, man, I appreciate all of the support, man. Big shouts out to everybody that donates to the channel. A special shouts out to all of my sponsors, especially my Pro Bowl sponsors, whose name you see scrolling on the screen right now. Man, I really appreciate all y'all. I'll catch y'all later. I'm out.